My primary point is about the fact that in dispensing with the idiocy on the so-called left, we now find ourselves headed in the direction of the right. And one thing that you and I have noticed a lot is it's not that there are no exceptions. In fact, there are some profound exceptions. But on the right, there is often a failure to appreciate the importance of a broader environmental viewpoint. Mm-hmm. That the earth is actually in really bad shape. I didn't say anything about climate.
Right.
The earth is in really bad shape in the sense that what we're doing to nature, what we are dispersing into nature in terms of unnatural chemicals that disrupt animal physiology, what we're doing to nature in terms of altering the vegetation, it's very patchy, it's hard for animals to get from one place to another. We're disrupting all kinds of stuff on which they're depending.
And there's a reductionist view that treats all the things that we have named as commodities. So, okay, so we lost a, you know, few thousand, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of hectares of tropical forest. Well, but we just plant some forest up in the, you know, make it boreal forest up in Saskatchewan, it'll be fine. Well, forest isn't forest. Forest isn't commodity. And it's not to say that, you know, counting how many board feet of some particular species that you can get out of a particular stand of trees doesn't have real economic truth and value. But forest isn't forest any more than, you know, a wild fox is the same as a domesticated dog. I think you tried to preempt the antagonism that will come back, which is wild nature is not doing well. We are both you know, paving over paradise and putting things into it, most of which none of us agreed to in the first place. But there's also a sense, not on all of the people who think of themselves on the right, but almost entirely on the right, that that it's here for us anyway, that that we should be free to do whatever we want with nature because that's what it's here for. And, you know, you and I slightly disagree on how we might frame what we should do. And your framing actually says, you know what, we should act like we are needing to do things for humans.
If we prioritize value to humans, you end up arriving at what I think is the correct moral understanding, which is that we are obligated not to degrade the planet. If future humans, the value they derive from planet Earth is as important to us as what we derive, then the idea is you're not allowed to wreck the place.
And for me, the risk there is that people hear that and hear it as a literal rather than a metaphorical stance. I mean, a little bit like what you were suggesting about Dave Smith's understanding of what you said about God and religion on Tucker last week. So it is not that we are arguing that we can't mess, that we have no rights, that other organisms should be understood to have equal rights as humans. But the binary nature of environmentalism is insane. And as such, and this is, you know, this part of it isn't, you know, is a mistake that many people on the right are making, but it was handed to them by people on the left making a mistake, which is the conflation of environment with climate change.
Yep. So you get people, you get market forces causing people to monetize wild foxes. The instinct is, well, I'm going to travel a long way. I'm going to be spending my time and effort. Mm-hmm. So, you know, so you get a long lens and you stand around the den and you document this thing that is utterly amazing. And, you know, then you post it on your Instagram and everybody is envious that you got to see the thing. Or, you know, maybe you're semi-professional and you try to sell the images. But nonetheless, the point is, this is actually a degraded relationship with nature that is manifesting in this way. And part of the problem is we are supposed to be having regular encounters with nature, all of us. Nature is supposed to be a large fraction of what we interact with. And the relationship that develops is that things like a fox, as amazing as it is actually, it's a common enough animal that in many places with people, it's a nuisance. In fact, I was surprised when I was in London the last time. I was walking home at night, like 8 or 9 at night, and a fox, you know, happened across my path, clearly living right in the city of London. Mm-hmm. So anyway, the point is people should be having a lot more encounters with nature. And when you do to nature what we are doing, you restrict it to the tiny remote places, which then get ruined because when people want to encounter nature, they have to go to those places, which degrades them further. And so the what you have to do to see this stuff is getting more and more remote. And that is itself an unnatural relationship. So maybe we should show something. None of these images are the foxes at the lighthouse. If you pay a little attention, you know, we are lucky enough to live here. So, you know, we're back and forth across the island. We can notice patterns and see where animals are, and we can figure out where they are. So,
and they're interestingly, actually the first spring that we lived here, you saw kits emerge, in late April at a different den, neither where we're going to show you pictures from, nor the one at the lighthouse. And the following year there were again kits coming out of that same den, and we don't see them now. So
probably because that den was rabbit fed.
And right. It was very much in the center of where all the rabbits were. And there, you know, we've seen a couple of rabbits this year, but you used to see hundreds. So, you know, part of what being an animal behaviorist is, which is to say an observer of nature, and all of us, and this is what I'm writing for my book, but like all of us can and should develop the skills to see what is actually in front of us, and then learn how to interpret what it means. And so when you live in a place and you have your eyes open, you learn to detect the patterns that indicate something like, there are kits somewhere near here that are going to be emerging soon.
Right, and you will see, even in what, you know, Heather and I have been looking at these things, you know, we see them many times a day. We go and watch for a long period of time. There's still lots of mystery. There's lots of stuff I can't answer about the foxes that we are coming to know pretty well, which tells you something. It is part of the magic of nature, is that this is unexpected. And even for animal behaviorists confronted with animals that they begin to be able to recognize, it is not like, oh, well, this is that behavior and this is that behavior.
Yeah.